हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल? हेलो,
यस रोशनी, यू आर
हेलो एवरीवन, गुड आफ्टरनून. दिस इज रोशनी तिवारी. आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू पाइकास्ट, येट अनदर 3 o'clock स्टूडियो एपिसोड 8, प्रेजेंटिंग अ कलेक्शन ऑफ बेस्ट आर्किटेक्चरल ड्राइंग डिजाइंस वर्क्स फ्रॉम सेम 4 and 6 by our own students. So I request Purva Rane from SEM 6 to carry away with her presentation on government school.
Thank you, Roshni. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, Purva.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. So the topic for semester 6 architectural design studio was a reimagination of municipal school for marginalized user group based in Shramik Vasahat, Pune. So coming to the topic, in the very first beginning of the studio, our objective was to observe and analyze the municipal schools in our surroundings. Of the two schools that we got to interview, both of them were set in rural or semi-urban landscapes. This brought us to a question in mind: who are the subaltern? It made us ponder over how different are their lives as marginalized communities and how has urbanization been a toll on them. In spite of all of the scenario, this school in Ratnagiri district was a surprise for us. As you can see in the plan, the school sits on a tiny plot in seclusion, but the students run it all by themselves, right from growing food, nurturing, providing services, and generating funds. So how much ever small in scale, this makes it a proper institution. Coming to the site, this is a section through Shramik Vasahat in Pune, where a set of observations were noted, such that having extremely crowded homes with more than 5 to 6 people living in the same house and the upper floors being rented, school and college going students find it difficult to study at home. With the cramped up spaces, children have found themselves engaged in street games in spite of the hustle and bustle. All these households are a slum of small scale businesses, which include cooking and women upliftment groups. Many times students do engage in allied activities from in and around the slum, such as to fund the needs of the family, and this results into eventually getting dropped out of school. The divide. The road is a very harsh divide between privileged in MIG colonies and the slums overflowing with water and poor infrastructure on the left, right. In the design, we look forward to bridging this deep divide of only the subaltern being part of municipal schools, where we raise the bar such that all parts of the society are able to access it. Coming to the three ideas around which the design is based. So because midday meals are a very important part of municipal school, it had to be characterized with a midday meal hall, which will cater to the students' need of food and water throughout the day. Social creation. In a school which has both vernacular and English medium study patterns, there is always a sociological divide among students. Myself, being from a school which had both of the study patterns, it does have a sense of a divide between the two of them. In order to bridge the gap and to inculcate team building notion in a child, the vernacular and English medium classes can come together for one creative subject of art and craft. This will also help on saving resources. Physical activity. During the pandemic, we all have understood the importance of physical activity. These courtyards can act as important buffer, but also provide an induced change in activities throughout the moment in the school. Another two are self-discovery and mindful thinking. As children, we are always curious of scratching our pens and pencils on the wall. This uncontrollable urge to draw on the wall as a child is common in everyone. In order to boost this exploration process of a mine, the walls could be foldable panels where infill is a canvas or a drawing board or simply a blackboard. Mindful thinking. For a child who grows up in a slum, always compromises in terms of academics in some or the other manner. In an urban scape where students are bound to coaching classes and other attractions for their academic, the self-study corner will allow them to dedicate a certain amount of time during the day to focus on academics. The study corner will give them a space devoid of audio and visual disturbances. It will create a peaceful and quiet environment for them to study in. Coming to the 3D massing. So as you can see, the site is a contoured site with a 4-meter wide road in front. The contour allowed us to have 8-meter corridors which will escalate and descend the site. It also gave rise to an X-shaped corridor flanked with classroom blocks allowing spatial hierarchy. This creates a matrix forming different courtyards of various sizes throughout the site. Then came the placing of service blocks on three corners of the site. Another challenge of dealing with a building having multiple courtyards is to manage and limit the use and number of courtyards that it brings with it. And lastly, the longitudinal dining area. Coming to the plan, you can see the entrance from the 4-meter wide road, from where the road leads till the assembly area. The entrance is in the double heighted. The main entrance is into the double heighted assembly area where it leads to this entire huge 8-meter corridor of courtyards with classrooms on both sides. It escalates onto the upper level with again classes on both sides and then onto the last service block for the common facilities and the staff room. This is my visualization of the courtyards which are being formed. The other hand of the corridor extends till the dining area such that it creates another set of two courtyards, one for drinking water facility and other as a spillout. The kitchen is located on the rear side and is accessible from the road in the site. This is how the drinking water courtyard looks like. In the floor plans, you can see the longitudinal library area, which is formed above the dining hall and which has a circular opening, and the laboratories on the first and second floor as well. In the section, this section cuts through the laboratories and longitudinally through the classrooms. Here you can see the drop-in level creating different kinds of courtyards. The one with the retaining wall acting as a playing pit, and the one which is linking two classrooms and acting as a playing corridor. Here you can also see the corridors being protruding out of the structure and the large dining hall on the ground floor. In this section cuts through four of the classrooms where the major difference is seen in the sill level and the level differences. On the ground floor, the sill level is limited to 450 so that the students can cross it immediately into the spillout area. And on the first floor, the sill height is limited to 900 mm. The elevation block. In the elevation, you can spot the elevations being characterized as foldable panels throughout the site. It also gives us a fair idea of how the spillout will be working, which will allow students to come out of the four walls of a classroom. In the elevation below, you can see the pilotis cutting through the library block, reaching till the roof. This allows four different niches to be formed, acting as the self-study corner, which were mentioned earlier. The working of the typical classroom. In this, you can see the two classrooms which are functioning individually for their subjects. In scenario 2 and 3, you can see the use of these boards and these foldable panels to make sure to engage the students out of the classrooms and within themselves for art and craft classes. This is the section of the typical classroom where again you can see the students on the ground floor are being allowed spilling out of the classroom into the plinth which is extended outside of the classroom. You can also see the two classrooms are being connected together with these foldable panels where students can work on the boards. Similarly, the boards are being used on the upper floor and the use of waffle slab. The elevation of the classroom. In the elevation, you can see the characterized differences in the ground and the first floor, where the lower part of the panel is a blackboard or a canvas, and the upper part is a glass or a tinted panel. This is the explored axonometric view of the library and the midday hall, where on the ground floor, you can see the dining hall flanked with drinking water fountain on one side and the washrooms on the other side. You can also spot the kitchen, and above which you have the meditation area and the library on the first floor. Here you can see the self-study corner being created because of the niches of the Pilates. And again, the Pilates being extended on the roof level. These are the strip section details of the panel and the glass infill, where you can see the waffle slab and how the ends of the waffle slab are being connected to the infill panel and then all to the sill levels. On the right side, you can see the detail of the self-study corner, which allows a 650 mm of brick wall, above which there's a 350 mm railing, which will allow visual connection of the student while studying into the courtyards below. This is the axonometric view of the entire site. And on the right, you can see the views of the site. Thank you.
Thank you, Purva, for this consistent and structural presentation of your comprehensive work. Further, I request Faiz Kachu and Harita Nair from SEM 4 to start presenting their work on music.
Pronto plan. As the user enter the structure, he can find reception and waiting room. Moving along the passage, on the left hand side, he can find a courtyard which acts as a buffer space. On right hand side, there is an entry to the landscape. On coming back to the left hand side, there is gallery 1 and 2. Down at the south, we have a toilet for handicapped male, female, and staff. Underground floor plan. Coming down to the basement, we have a skylight at the top. Moving down, we have PR, AV room. Moving into this passage, we have curator's cabin, service room. Coming back to the lobby, we have ADSEM4 museum.
Case studies. The case studies we chose for contextual architecture were Vitra Museum, Houses of Goa, School of Dancing Arches, and Hussein Loshe Gufa. From these case studies, we adapted design strategies best suitable for hot and dry climate, like skylights for ventilation and natural lighting, courtyards, charlie walls for passive cooling strategies, and use of locally available materials, etc.
Site context. Our given site is situated near Dauladabad Fort in Aurangabad district. The total area given is 3,520 meters square. Various resort park and water park are situated in around 1.5 kilometer of radius, making it an hotspot for tourists. NH52 highway makes the accessibility easy.
We did site analysis with respect to factors like sun path, wind direction, green cover, sound and traffic factor, which helped in placing the skylights accordingly for natural diffuse lighting and ventilation by placing skylight openings in direction of the wind, that is northeast. Green cover for placing of the seating areas under the shadow of the trees, and sound and traffic for orientation or placing of the spaces.
Topography. Site has presence of a black soil and surrounded by various deciduous trees, which are up to 12 meter in height. Aurangabad falls in a hot and dry region with low humidity, less rainfall, and the wind flows from northeast. User analysis. Tourists and locals from every group will be visiting the site, and afternoon is the peak time. SWOT analysis. The strength of the site is existing trees, hotel, resort, tourist attractions. Weakness. Direct sun exposure, poor public transportation accessibility, and vehicle sound are the weakness. Opportunities. Natural integrated pavilion design. Tourist hotspots are the opportunities we can find here. Then traits, followed by the traits like harsh, sun-exposed, barrier land, and narrow roads.
Concept and form development. We derived our concept from the geometrical alignment of Bibi Ka Maqbara. Our design is contextual, inspired from the hexagon-shaped minarets of Bibi Ka Maqbara, underground structure inspired from the Ajanta caves, and circulation path inspired from the Daulatabad fort. We developed our form into hexagon as it helped create more faces, leave no waste space, and is more strong and harmonious. Design strategies. We adapted design strategies like small cutouts along the wall of the galleries, jali wall, and courtyard for passive cooling and ventilation in response to hot and dry climate. Skylights are provided above the galleries and cafeteria for natural lighting. Also, the openings are given at northeast direction of the skylight for ventilation purpose.
Site zoning. So, zone 1 consists of VR, courtyard, gallery 1, 2, 3, AB storage and storeroom. The total space, the total area of zone 1 is 1200 meter square. Zone 2 consists of landscape, toilet, souvenir shop, reception, waiting room, toilet, manager room and conference room. The total area of zone 2 is 260 square meter. Coming to the zone 3, we have a cafeteria, pantry and storeroom. The total area is 220 square meter. The total built up area is 2000 square meter. Massing. Hexagon being our form, we have differentiated it in various shapes for different spaces with underground floor. Coming to the ground level, we have split the hexagon into half to associate with the galleries and the courtyard. Coming to the upper level, we have splitted the hexagon into two shapes. This is this our main site plan. This is the main entry to the site. On left hand side, we have a parking, and on right hand side, we have a temporary space where the local artist can exhibit their art and craft work. Moving along the site, on left hand side, we have a small sit out space. Moving within the site, we have a large sit-out space for the users. At the edge of the site, we have a hanging sitting beneath the tree. Moving into the site, we have a landscape toilet. Moving along with it, we have a small sit-out space. And over here, we have a service entry. Ground floor plan. As the user enter the structure, he can find reception and waiting room. Moving along the passage, on the left hand side, he can find a courtyard which acts as a buffer space. On right hand side, there is an entry to the landscape. On coming back to the left hand side, there is gallery 1 and 2. Down at the south, we have a toilet for handicap, male, female, and staff. Underground floor plan. Coming down to the basement, we have a skylight at the top. Moving down, we have VR room, AV room. Moving into this passage, we have curator's cabin, service room. Coming back to the lobby, we have a manager room and conference room. Moving back to the lobby, we have storeroom and storage room. Coming to the first floor is split into two. One half is for cafeteria, pantry, and kitchen. Another half is for gallery. Coming down from the stairs leads to the landscape and souvenir shop.
The site section is cut south side of the site showing security cabin in the left, followed by staff toilet, female handicap and male toilet, and hexagon seating area. Also, it shows the contoured levels of the site with immediate site context. The following site section cuts from the west side, showing courtyard, cafeteria, and male toilet. Southwest elevation. This is the elevation showing main structural entrance and gallery facades. The glass windows at first floor of Gallery 3 are given to get view of Daulatabad Fort, as Gallery 3 depicts more of its history. North elevation shows the rear view of the structure, showing entrance towards the Gallery 3 and cafeteria, and exit towards the landscape from the passage through courtyard. This elevation shows the cutouts on the Gallery 1 and 2 facade, which is on the ground floor, and entrance towards the first floor. East side elevation shows staircase, which acts as an exit staircase for the structure for first floor towards the landscape. Building section. This building section shows interior of VR in the underground, Gallery 1 and 2, and courtyard on the ground floor, and cafeteria, pantry storage, Gallery 3, and exit passage on the first floor. This section shows interior of ground floor and underground floor, showing VR, curator's cabin, director's cabin, conference room, and storage on underground floor, followed by Gallery 1 and 2 and staff toilet on the ground floor. The following section, EE, is cut through reception area, waiting area, and maintenance room. And the section FF dash is cut through security cabin, which is located at the main entrance of the site. For the following section is cut through east side, showing Gallery 3 interior on the first floor, followed by reception, waiting room, and maintenance room with a landscape toilet on the ground floor.
Material detail and construction. We have used polycarbonated sheet for the skylights, concrete for floorings, exposed brick for the walls, and a basalt stone for courtyard and passage flooring. This is the ground floor interior detail with the circulation, and these are the views. Coming to the underground interior details, these are the views. First floor interior details. These are the views. Landscape views. This is the overall structure with a view along the immediate site context. Walkthrough.
Thank you, both of you, for this appealing and continual presentation of your detailed work. With this, let's conclude the studio. Thank you to Dr. Sudhya ma'am, all the faculty members, Faiz Kasu, Harita Nair, Purva Rane, the students, and the council body for your time and contribution. Have a good day.